Rmn podcast. How are you, sir?
I'm not too bad at all, thank you, Rog. I've got ready for this and raring to let you know all the details that you need to know.
Well, let's start at the beginning, John. The big beginning for, not for you just yet, but the beginning for me, because it would be 1989 or 1990 or something like that. I was in Tenerife and I was on holiday, and I was a DJ at that time myself. And I walked into a club called Fever, and I'd seen a lot of DJs, I'd done a lot of DJ sets over in the UK and what have you. And I walk in, and you know, nobody had said, it wasn't like in the days of the hustlers trying to get you into the nightclubs and what have you. This was just like a sporadic decision. I'm walking into this nightclub, and I walked in and I heard you MCing. First of all, the first thing you did was you did a little bit of MCing, and then you dropped into a drum. You had like a kind of drums and things like that. You started playing drums and you were mixing. And I came back from Tenerife at that point in time saying, this is the best DJ I have ever seen in my life. Just recently, I did a podcast with Des Mitchell, and I don't think Des was too happy when I said the best DJ in the world was John Browne. but I did say that anyway. But you know, but I mean, amazing, and you know, and you inspired me so much so that because we were in Fever that night in Tenerife, I named my first album with JBC Victor in Japan and Asia back in 1999, and I called the album Fever. It was that good a set. I mean, that's an inspiration to put on somebody for a set. I mean, it was for a DJ. I mean, it was amazing. So I'm pretty humbled to be here today. It's pretty cool because, you know, so where did it all start for John Browne, and how did you get so bloody good?
But it started in Lincoln, actually, in a club called Trilby's. And from Trilby's, I stayed with the club, but the club changed itself from Trilby's to Rothschild's to Lasers, and now it's called Sugar Cubes. I left when it was Lasers and moved out, branched out a little bit. I went to a couple of clubs like Tipsy Toad, out at Cambridge Corner, Fat Sam's out near between Ollerton and Retford. And I got a call from the doorman, who was the brother of one of the owners out there called Mrs. T's in Tenerife.
Okay.
Calling was given by Roger, and Roger asked me to come over, offering me lots of things to actually encourage me to stay. And from there, I worked Mrs. T's, and then I went to Tramps, and from Tramps to Fever, back to Tramps, and then to La Rocca. From La Rocca, that's when I, that was the last club I worked. I worked a few parties up in the north as well. La Laguna, the Monkey Club, Pasha, and some of the raves as well. Oh my gosh, with Simon Baseline Smith and various Bananas.
Bananas, I played Bananas way back. That was my first ever gig on the Balearic Islands was Bananas.
Yeah, it was Bananas, really dark and really obscene music, but absolutely phenomenal.
It was indeed. Yeah. I mean, for you, John, I mean, why did you get into DJing in the first place? What was the purpose? You know, I mean, because I mean, for me, I think it was more rap music or the breakdance scene, if you like, because breakdance came out and the scratching and things like that from breakdance, the movie, and that was the first time. I think I pleaded with my parents all year to get a turntable for my Christmas, and I was a young kid, you know, at that time, and I did breakdancing and body popping, and I wanted to do the scratching, and that's really what got me into the DJing thing, and kind of, you know, mix the break beats with the other break beats and create something. But it was mainly hip hop that got me into DJing. What got you into DJing?
Well, surprisingly, when I was 11 and a half, I got my first chance. I wanted to DJ well before then, but I couldn't get the opportunity. All the DJs that were playing wouldn't allow me to go near the decks. They thought, oh no, not having some young pup going on and wrecking my equipment. So 11 and a half in the school disco, I was able to play my first record, which was the Monster Mash. I don't know if you can remember that.
I do, of course. I remember the Monster Mash. Yeah, absolutely. It's a graveyard smash.
That's it. That's the one. From there, I worked with a friend who wasn't a very good friend in the end, but I worked with a friend on a mobile disco.
Okay.
And then I worked with another friend on a mobile disco. And then I got my own collection of Northern Soul, which was a suitcase of Northern Soul, which unfortunately disappeared along with other collections. But I started with that Northern Soul collection and started playing them out.
Amazing.
And from there, I carried on. I moved into Trilby, as I say, quite young, about 17, I think I was, or even younger. And from Trilby's, I started playing back in the day, it wasn't hip-hop and stuff that was available. It was mainly, I was playing various tunes like funk, soul, jazz funk, and reggae, ragga, and various stuff like that. And as it progressed, we started playing more hip hop, funk, more jazz funk, and various house that was coming along, Chicago house and that type of stuff that came along over the years. And it developed every type of genre that I could enjoy as dance music, I played in that club. And then it changed to, as I say, to Rothschild's, and we played the more selective tunes. And then there was a Cinderella Rockefellers that was available here in Lincoln, which was a good club, very big club. Rockefellers was upstairs, Cinderella's was downstairs. And I played a little bit in there, and then I was encouraged to go back to Lasers, which was the old Trilby's and Rothschild's. And I stayed there for quite a while until I got the opportunity, as I said, to spread my wings a little bit. And then from Cambridge Corner, I got the calling to Tenerife. Was there for 8 years. My gosh.
That's amazing. That is amazing. I mean, when you talk about house music coming in, and the first house music coming in, for me, I think the song that I first started playing would have been Jack Your Body. You remember Jack Your Body? Jack. That was the first record that I played. What was your kind of first house record that you played at the time?
Andy Pandy, was it? And All About House Music.
All About House. Music, yeah, amazing, amazing, yeah. Amazing. I mean, for you, John. I mean, look, I work in the scene. So do you now? You're obviously drum and bass now. We'll come to that as we get on. But you progress like a musician, I suppose, that starts out playing rock bands and then maybe goes into a funk band, and then by the end of the career, they end up in a jazz band, you know, and that seems to be what happens. And the sad thing is that that's the smallest part of the industry is the jazz scene, and they end up going out to the jazz scene, and they're brilliant musicians, they can play anything, but they get bored of playing the standard keys and chords, and they end up doing the jazz. And you've done the same thing. You've went all the way through the genres and ended up in the drum and bass world, which for me is the EDM jazz world, you know, really. But I mean, it must be frustrating for you, John, because, or certainly it might not be for you, but it is for me, to see and go over to Ibiza, to go to some of these clubs in America and watch these DJs now. They can't entertain. They've got no charisma whatsoever. They're struggling to mix, and what they are mixing, they're syncing. They're pressing the sync button, sync. They're not having to get it in cue and in time, and you know, use tempo shifts. I mean, these people are just pressing a sync button. That's it. And you know, they've made millions, and they're big headliners all over the world. And I mean, what's your view on that? I mean that must frustrate you, because I mean, you were, probably still are, I've not seen you for a long time, but I mean, you were, for me, the best DJ in the world.
Well, for me, to catch all the sync and all the new technology that's come along, I don't knock it to that extent, but I'm not the DJs who use it in that way and haven't had the experience to learn. You understand me? Because when I went to Tenerife, I went there to learn more about the trade, my trade, and do what I was capable of regarding the drumming, the hand percussion, the sampler. Can you remember the sampler in Tramps? I had a keyboard sampler that I could do various things with it. And for me, it just defeats the object. If you haven't been able to go in there and learn about mixing, about various, how can you turn around and give advice to other people? You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. Personally, I still mix, but I know my BPM, so it makes it much, much easier for me to mix and do what I'm doing, and also incorporate what I'm doing into what I want to achieve. Like, for instance, when I started DJing, I was playing other people's music, and all my life I've been playing other people's music and mixing it down, making up new ideas. Like I did a mix of playing with knives and a soul a cappella. And instead of playing it at normal speed, I played it at half the speed and then mixed them together, and it sounded wonderful. And within that evening, I went on my break, and I saw somebody actually trying to do the mix in another nightclub. You know what I mean? So I presume, well, I class myself as an innovator rather than a copier.
I remember you took Booker T in the Green Onions.
Oh, yes.
And
sat myself, by the way.
Yeah, you took Booker T, Green Onions, and you slowed it down. Oh, no, sorry, you speeded it up, and then you put a big, you know, kind of club groove on it, and the place went mental. And I loved that because, you know, you're playing a 70s record on vinyl, and you've just dropped in And of course, there was no studio time or anything. This was you doing this live in the club at the moment, and dropping in the hook lines of, you know, Fever, the beat, let's rock, you know, da, 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 and you did all these little things on top. And I'm like, this is entertaining as hell. And you're dropping in a little drum roll. And I'm like, shit, this guy's good.